from verse 28. But before I go there, I want to go to two places in the Old Testament. The first is Deuteronomy 6, verse 4.
Love the Lord your God
and love your neighbor. That, as far as I can tell, has never been seen before. And the man is impressed. God said, teacher, he says. He's impressed with the answer. This is an occasion where Jesus has a genuine conversation with one of these guys. Lots of the build-up to this have been attempts to trap Jesus, to catch Jesus in his words. So you get the Pharisees and Herodians, 13. Then you get the Sadducees, verse 18. And they're all coming with questions designed to get Jesus into trouble, either with the crowds or with the authorities. Designed to get rid of Jesus, actually. And this was true for lots of these religious leaders. It reminds us, doesn't it, that it's possible to be very religious, very pious, perhaps, and yet to hate God. The parable at the very beginning of this chapter, the parable of the tenants or the farmers, the wicked tenants, perhaps, shows us that the heart of human beings, and even very religious human beings, is the desire to kill God, to get rid of God, to do away with God and His Son, His Messiah, His chosen one. But this guy, he comes on his own, that's different, and has a seat of a genuine question for Jesus, and Jesus answers it in a very plain, speaking, straightforward way. And that's unusual again in this part of Mark, as the build-up things are ramping up to the cross. Jesus gives a very straight answer. He doesn't answer with a parable, he doesn't answer with a series of another question, as we see earlier on. He just gives a very clear question. And he obviously has found a religious leader who is genuine, who is asking an honest question at last. And the man comes back to him with approval in 32. You are right in saying that God is one, there is no other but Him. And rather like Jesus, he adds another strand to the answer. You notice how Jesus does this initially. The man asks for one commandment, and Jesus gives him two. That must be because the two are linked. They are related. We find this all throughout the Bible, actually. Love for God and love for neighbor are married, if you like. Two sides of the same coin, however you want to look at it. So the Ten Commandments, for example, you'll be aware, has 1 to 4, love for God, and then 5 to 10, love for neighbor. Even the Lord's Prayer has something of that structure, that division about it. The first part is, your kingdom, may your name be hallowed, your kingdom come, your will be done. And then we're into love of the neighbor, you know, ourselves included. Provide for us all that we need, forgive us our sins, and protect us or keep us from temptation. So again, there's that structure, isn't there? Unless you go, if you went into, for example, into 1 John, you find that John probably was standing here listening to this conversation. He was one of the disciples who was closest to Jesus. You cannot love God without loving people. It's an overflow of loving God. And the evidence that you love God is that you love your brothers and sisters, your neighbor, your enemies even. The evidence that you love the God who you cannot see is that you love the neighbor who you can see. And so the two are always linked. Love for God and love for neighbor. And then the scribe or the teacher of the law, as he's called in 28, also adds to Jesus' answer something. He says to love God this way and to love your neighbors yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. Now that's hugely significant because they were standing in the temple courts at this time. This was around the time when Jesus had cleared the temple, kicked off all kinds of anger and reaction amongst the leaders. For one of these religious guys to say that was a significant thing. Bigger and more important, even in Jerusalem, even at the site of the temple where these things took place, he acknowledges And he's on the right track because Jesus commends him. He acknowledges that to love God with all your heart, understanding, strength, and love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices. Think of the thousands. Henry started with that passage from Hebrews 9:11 to 12, when he said love, but reminding us, thanks, that those things are, you know, those things took place, of course, under the old covenant, but are no longer required for us. I think how many thousands, you know, these numbers have been calculated, I don't know what they are, thousands and thousands of offerings and sacrifices would have been made. More important than that is that you love God with all your being and you love your neighbor as yourself. This part of the Bible then reminds us what is most important in life. It's quite simple, but it is to love God and to love our neighbor. These are the two prime requirements laid down by Jesus. These are the two prime requirements for you in life, for your children in life. What do you want for your children? You should want more than anything that they love God with their whole being, as much as they can, and love their neighbors as themselves. That should be your desire for your heart, for yourself, for your children, for your friends, for your family, and for your church. Sure is here. Now, it's worth noticing, I think, what he does not say. He doesn't say, love the planet. You know, Jesus does talk a lot, doesn't he, about the birds, the flowers, for example, in Matthew 6, he's encouraging us not to not to worry about things, but to look at the birds in the air, consider them, and then consider the flowers and the lilies of the field, and how God clothes them, how God takes care of the birds, and you are worth more, he says, than many sparrows. I was looking at this up on Google, and sparrows are everywhere. They're pretty much one of the most common birds in the world. You can find them all across the globe, I think, pretty much. Israel, you could buy them to eat them. I don't know what they taste like. Pretty bite-sized snack, I would imagine. But you could get 2 for a penny, or the kind of the original Bible getting free deal was that you could get 5 for 2 pennies. It's 2 for a penny or 5 for 2 pennies. And so just very, very common, but God takes very special care of these little things, these little tiny, tiny little birds. And he says, well, worth more than many sparrows. So, and I think God has a care for the planet and a care for nature. And you can even find laws in the law of Moses, the Torah, that talk about care for animals and care for the planet and care for the environment. There are verses encouraging care for the land. They're not in the top two. Fine to be keen on ecological concerns and a green planet and so on, but keep it in perspective, keep it where it belongs. They should not be too important to you. Okay, but it's not something to get obsessed about. He doesn't say, love animals, birds, some of us love animals. Special, regard for animals. And again, you can find laws in the law of Moses encouraging people to look after their beasts, their animals. But they're not at the top of the list. They're not that important. You must put before that love for God and love for people. It can be a lot easier to love an animal than if you've got pets at home. Probably one or two of you have a dog or a cat. Maybe a goldfish, I don't know. It's a lot easier, isn't it? Because they don't answer back. More complicated with people, because people are more complicated. And they can give you a lot more trouble. God, Jesus doesn't even say love humanity in general. That's very easy. It's very easy to be like a great campaigner or two. Not very easy, or it's not very easy, but it's a lot easier to have like to sign a check for a charity, or to click a donate button online for a charity, or perhaps even to be involved in demonstrations. That can be a lot easier, let me say, than caring for a single individual, a different person,
You know what I'm saying? That kind of thing, you know, the live aid thing, that kind of, not knocking live aid particularly, but in some ways, you know, that kind of thing, make poverty history, it is, you know, love for humanity in general, but actually, in some ways, not that difficult to jump on board that. Loving a single individual, see, Jesus says, love your neighbor. And I take from that he means not humanity in general, in kind of a sweeping way, but those people in your life around you who might be difficult to love. Love your neighbor. So I think it's important just to see what he's saying here. Someone has put it this way: to love the whole world for me is no chore. My only real problem is my neighbor next door. Sometimes your neighbor next door can be really difficult to deal with, and however much you might have love for humanity in general, the rub comes when you're dealing with the guy next door. Of course, neighbor means not just the guy living next door. It means Jesus means, as we know from Luke 10, the parable of the Good Samaritan, he means anyone you come across in need, including strangers and enemies. Because Samaritans and Jews were strangers and indeed enemies. Love your particular neighbors, people you come across. So these are the top two commandments, the top two requirements, the two greatest things you can do and achieve in life. The two greatest things you can do and achieve in life is to love God with all your being, with all your heart, and to love your neighbor as yourself. We should put these before everything else. We can love things, can't we, and use people. We can love phones. We can love computers. We can love video games. We can love sport. Men can love sport, women love sport too. But we can love it too much, and we can put it ahead of our love for God and for people. Great Christian, you probably have heard of Augustine, or sometimes called St. Augustine, spoke of our problem being disordered love. Disorder is when you get your loves out of order. So when you love, it's top of your list, perhaps it's not God. And second is not people or neighbors, but it's something else. And you've got the whole list out of order. That's the problem. We have lots in our heart for things that are too powerful, too strong. And they're not the loves we should have for him who loves us with his whole being, the Lord himself. Love God with all your heart. Interesting, Jesus adds one. All your heart, your soul, your mind is the one that he adds to Deuteronomy 6:4, and all your strength. But the repetition of all just brings home the sheer the wholeness of this. All. He wants us to love God with our whole being. The message puts it this way, quite helpfully: love the Lord God with all your passion, heart, prayer, soul, intelligence, mind, and energy, strength. So passion, prayer, intelligence, energy. We should have that kind of love for God that is, it's just so much greater than we have for anything or anyone else, be it family, be it sport, whatever it might be, that occupies the throne of our hearts, the desires of our hearts, the dreams of our hearts, if you like. He wants us to love God more than anything, with a passion and an energy. And to love our neighbor, the people around us, the people we come across in life, perhaps even the people we bump into, anyone in need around you. And to do so as we love ourselves. Now, what does that mean? Is this, you see, you read a lot of, you type into Google or look up modern commentaries. A lot of it's in Google, to be fair. The they'll give you three commandments, right? Love God, love neighbor, love yourself. Is that what Jesus is saying here? Is he in fact giving us three commandments? But he said only two. He said the most important one is this, and the second is this. Well, I think that's a pretty big clue, isn't it? He says there's only two great commandments here. There's not a third great commandment to love ourselves. Now, I mean, that doesn't mean we don't have a sense of what God has done for us. It doesn't mean we can't say, like David says in Psalm 139, I praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. You can say that. You should say that. We should say that. The way he's made us is fearful and wonderful. It inspires awe in us. But this is not about self-love. It's not about self-esteem. I think you have a hard job finding self-esteem in the Bible. I don't think it's there. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's more of a guide to how you should love your neighbor. In other words, the way you look after yourself, the way you care for yourself, when you're tired, when you're hungry, when you're run down, when you're feeling ill, whatever, the way you look after yourself in that moment, you should do the same for your neighbor, even a stranger, even your enemy. It's not a command to love yourself, but to love people in the same way and as much as you already do for yourself. I think that must be what the meaning of here is. It's a command to love people around you as you already and naturally do for yourself. And it can't mean, I don't think, love yourself, because just in a few verses earlier on, well, four chapters, in chapter 8, Jesus says that a disciple is someone who denies himself. Denies himself doesn't sit well with loving himself. There will be times when we sacrifice our own comfort, our own well-being, for the sake of another person, for the sake of their neighbor. It's not a very great commandment, in other words. It helps us understand how to love them as we already love ourselves. And we turn that around to our neighbors. Love, of course, in the Bible, it is not just a feeling. It's not just a feeling, a strange and woozy and magical feeling. That comes and goes. People who say, and I'm sure you've heard this, we're separating because we don't love each other anymore. That just doesn't make any sense in the Bible. To the Bible, to God. Because love is committing yourself to do another person good. Love is committing to do another person good. In Luke 6, I think 37, don't quote me on that, it could be 39. It's around there. Jesus is talking about loving enemies, praying for those who persecute, and doing good to them. And I think it's pretty clear there that loving your enemies and doing good to them are the same thing, essentially. To love someone is to do them good. That's the very heart of the Bible idea of love, committing to do someone good. And of course, when people commit to each other in a marriage ceremony, they promise that even if it makes their life worse, if it makes them poorer, and if the other person gets sick and they have to look after them, that they will continue to do that other person good, even if they don't feel like it. And even if the other person isn't returning the love. That is God's love, isn't it? That's God's love for us. He loves us when we're still enemies, when we're powerless, when we're sinners. This is not Hollywood. This is God's love in Christ. So love is more than a feeling, but equally, I want to say, because Christians often, I think, go down this route of duty, that love is not less than a feeling. Or should not be less than a feeling. Now, sometimes there are times when we just got to get on with it, and we got to do the right thing, perhaps with some sense of duty. But I don't think that when our love is rather cold-hearted that way, that we should be happy with that. We should settle for that. I think we should. I think we should repent of that. You know, I think we should long to have the compassion of Jesus. That word compassion that's used of Jesus is something, is a feeling that of course works itself out in action, but it's something that comes from right down here, actually, in the original language. It's a very deep feeling of love and concern and care for other people. So I don't want anybody to feel that we should settle for kind of cold-hearted, dutiful, you know, I'll do it because I have to kind of attitude. I hope God doesn't understand that. I hope he didn't say to us, I'll love you. I don't really feel like it, but why not? No, he doesn't. We know he doesn't. We have verses, don't we, like, do not grieve the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 4:30, with whom you seal for the day of redemption. Do not grieve him, do not make him sad. In Genesis 6:6, the flood, we're told that in this version, I think, that God's heart was filled with pain. That's emotional, that's feelings. I don't know, you know, whatever you want to do with that, however you want to interpret that, that is emotion. We don't want to be acting out of hard-hearted duty. We should be loving people and committed to it, even when we don't feel like it, but we do it praying that God will give us those genuine feelings of affection. We want it to come from the heart. We want it to come from the heart. Jesus is urging and encouraging disciples to forgive those who have offended. Remember that wonderful parable about the king? He says, you must forgive your brother from the heart. From the heart. Not just what so many people say. People said to me recently, I can forgive, but I will never forget. That's not forgiveness. That's not how he treats us. Right, so how can we do this? So this loving God with all our hearts, all our being, and loving our neighbour as ourselves is not something that comes to us naturally, at least not in our fallen state, not in sin. Sometimes as we look into our hearts, sometimes, often, we may find other things in there like bitterness and resentment and envy and even hate for other people, even for God. We need help. We need a miracle. We need God to change our hearts that we can love him and love people. Don't we? Aren't we deeply self-centered, really? Again, Augustine, I think, spoke about us being curved in upon ourselves. Like, it's a bit like a fetal position, isn't it? It's like, spiritually, we're a bit like that. We're curved in upon ourselves. We're self-centered. And it takes a miracle for God to make us other-centered, to look out to him and to others. Well, how does this work? Well, I think I heard him making reference to this in prayer, the height and the depth and the breadth of love. It's Ephesians 3. You could go there to help you with this. Here's a prayer. A man on his knees before the Father. It's Ephesians 3:14. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives his name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and mighty is the love of Christ, and to know this love, and so on. Here's a man who is praying that he might grasp and know and experience and taste the love of God that is in Christ Jesus and poured into his heart by the Holy Spirit. And he's going to the gospel, isn't he? Let's take three things out of this. He's praying. We need to pray for this heart of love for God and for each and for others. It can never happen without a prayer, without that miracle of the Holy Spirit. He's looking to the gospel. He's looking to Christ. Probably he's looking to the cross, the great demonstration. Of course he is. The great demonstration of God's love is in the cross. He tells us that in Romans. He's looking at the gospel. He's contemplating Christ. This is what we must do. We must go to the gospel. And then please notice also that he says he's going to do that together with all the saints, verse 18. And sometimes we forget that this is something we're to do together. We're supposed to do this not just on our own in our rooms, that's good, but we do it, for example, now, together. We come together on Sundays, other days, to grasp, it's something we do better together if we want to understand his love for us. And this then is the love that inspires and overflows in our hearts so that we love him and we love our neighbor as we love ourselves. As we look at the Father, God the Father, who loved the world so much, he gave his only Son. And we look again at the Son, who loved us so much, he gave himself for us on the cross. And the Holy Spirit, who gives himself to us, to live with us and in us. I don't know if you ever thought about the cost of redemption to the Holy Spirit. We're familiar, aren't we, that God the Father gave his one and only Son, his only begotten Son, John 3:16, did not spare him, Romans 8:32. And we're familiar with the love of the Son, the cost to the Son, and giving himself for us on the cross, and going through that hell of God-forsakenness, for us in our place, in my place, condemned he stood. But have we ever thought about the cost of the Holy Spirit of redemption? Well, I got this from a book called The Beauty and Glory of the Holy Spirit. I think it's some very good stuff in there. I think a chapter by Jeff Thomas brought this home to me, that there is a cost, that he has to live with us and in us. We who sin, we who grieve him. And he has to live with that every day. That's the price that he pays for redemption, or of redemption, and to sanctify and renew us. He is grieved by our sin, our anger, our envy. So we love in return and in response to God's love. You remember the words, I was just looking them up before I spoke, 1 John 4:19, we love because he first loved us. So it's as we look at the gospel, as we look at Christ, that we are drawn and empowered and by the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit willing to love in return. But we can't do it off our own bat. We can't love God this way off our own bat. We can't love our neighbors ourselves off our own bat, but through the gospel, by the gospel, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, praying, looking to the gospel, doing it together, he can inspire those living waters that flow out from within us to bless our people and to appreciate and to love him also. That's always the way, isn't it? You want to develop love in your Christian life. You can't pull yourself up by your own bootstraps. You can't do it off your own bat. What do? You go to the gospel. We love because he first loved us. Love as Christ loved us. You want to forgive. How do you forgive in Christian life? How do you forgive from the heart? When you're really offended, how do you deal with that? How do you forgive? Matthew 18, that parable tells us, we go to the gospel, we go to Jesus, we go to the cross, we remember, we appreciate all that he's done for us. And from that parable, we might get the sense, Holy Spirit willing, that of this sense, let's put it this way, how can I forgive? How can I refuse to forgive? How can I refuse to forgive this person who's offended me when I am being so forgiven? And when you get that, then you're empowered to forgive your brother from the heart. And it's the same with humility in Philippians 2, the same with giving in 2 Corinthians 8. He goes, he plugs it into the gospel. He says, look at Jesus, look at what he gave to you, what he did for you. That will be your inspiration. That I think is how Christian life works. We love because he first loved us. Just almost final thought here, possibly penultimate. I like this because it's true, and because Jesus said it, but I also like it because it can simplify life. To love God and to love neighbors, I love myself, it is the great goal of life for all Christians, for all humans. It is what it means to be truly human. that you love your creator, provider, redeemer, and judge, and you love the people around you as yourself. And I'm always looking for something to simplify life, I must admit. So your goal is not to have a great career. Your ultimate goal in life is not to have a great career, even a great marriage, a beautiful, clean and tidy house, to look fantastic, to lose weight, to write a book, to win lots of awards, to become famous, to get lots of qualifications, to have 2.4 children, to do 501 things before you die, or one of the latest ones is 1,001 restaurants you must experience before you die. What a lot of pressure that is. No, you don't need the bucket list. Your goal is simply to love God with all, I say simply, not simply. I know this is a very tall order, but made possible by the gospel and the Holy Spirit. Your goal is, let me say it again, simply, to simplify life, love God and love people. And that is what truly matters, because that is what truly matters to Him. That is what you will be judged on, the quality of your relationships. So if you want to be famous for loving people. And let love be the big thing in our churches. Let love be the big thing in our churches. Let it be the main thing in our churches between us. This really is the sign of a spirit-filled church, where there is love, where Jesus' love is real and visible amongst us, where people are being forgiven and patient with one another, and we are demonstrating Jesus to the world around us. You can get that from all over the place. Go to the Spiritual Gifts chapter, 1 Corinthians 12. You'll see that one of the great signs of being a spirit-filled church is that people love each other. So 13 as well, of course, chapter 13, the great love chapter. Or Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, and so on. This is the great sign, you see, that the church is a spiritual church. It's not miracles, not spirit, not great gifts, not words of wisdom or prophecy or whatever. The great sign, well, there's two great signs in Corinthians 12, glorifying Jesus, praising Jesus, because no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit, that's verse 3. And then secondly, love for one another. It's the way that people will see we are His disciples. It's the way that they will see that He is real and His love is real, because it is visible amongst us. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. We love because He first loved us. Let's pray. Our Father, we spend a whole lot of time, perhaps not enough, but on Sundays anyway, we often sing and think and preach about your love. We would pray that we make it real, Lord, in our hearts. We want to taste it, we want to experience it, we want to feel it in our hearts. The great love, the wonderful love that you have for us in Jesus, poured out into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Father, grant us, we pray, a fresh sense, a fresh appreciation of that divine, matchless, God-like love. Forgiving and freeing us, making us new creatures in Christ, adopting us, bringing us into your family, assuring us of a wonderful glory to come. Lord, we pray that by your wonderful grace, you would bless us in this way. Help us to look to the gospel often, to remember the wonderful grace that is shown in Lord Jesus Christ. And may it inspire and call forth in us a true love for you from our hearts, and a true love and concern and commitment to doing good to our neighbor, whoever he or she may be. And we pray in the name of Jesus and for his sake. Amen.